All right. Can anybody, everybody hear me good? Yes. Thank you for coming. I was surprised to find that I'm at this stage. Feels like Steve Jobs. Okay. So that's very interesting, a little bit intimidating. So give me a break, please. All right. So my name is Yury Magalif, and my session is tips and tricks for building VMware ESX with Virtual Connect FlexFabric, and I'm a senior solutions architect with ProMedia, a reseller and consulting company out of New Jersey. So, thank you for coming to the session. This is my second year for this particular session. Thank you for filling out the surveys. Because of that, I'm here. The criticisms, I always try to address the criticisms that you put in your survey comments. The main criticism is that my session has been too long, so I divided it into two pieces. Some of you may have attended my previous session 2 days ago, and some content is going to be repeated a little bit from the previous session, so I apologize ahead of time if you were attending my previous session. That's actually on purpose, because some people had not attended both sessions. And major criticisms I always get is I have no proof, numbers, or charts. That's because I have limited time. I have all the proof and numbers and charts, but I just can't give it to you here because I have too much information. In addition, this year HP only gave me 45 minutes, which is very little. So I had to cut out a third of my presentation out. So you'll get some of that in the slides that you'll get afterwards and that I could give you. The slides after this presentation, I'll come out with my laptop and I'll give you my slides as PDF, and of course HP can give you the slides maybe like a few weeks later also. You can download it off the website. But if you don't want to wait, I'll give them to you. Okay? And because, you know, I don't have proof or whatever, take my presentation with a grain of salt, use scientific method, hear me, hear other people, and then decide for yourself. I have a repeat of my previous session today at 1:30 in Tidian 2303. So we're going to go over firmware updates, general, and fiber channel design, mapped and tunneled mode, port channels and VLANs, the Cisco Nexus 1000V, the summary and the question and answer. I will answer your questions at the end. I did time the presentation, so I leave some time at the end. Okay. So the first thing we want to do is fulfill Virtual Connect firmware prerequisites. Virtual Connect firmware is very important. Why is it important? Because if you don't upgrade the firmware in one of the components in the blade enclosure or in the blades or in the Virtual Connect, you may see things work, but you won't get the full functionality. What I often see happening is a customer of mine installs the enclosure themselves, gets it up and going, doesn't really pay much attention, doesn't go through the wizards as well. Everything is up and running, and halfway down, maybe half a year later, he's like, well, let me see if I can use this virtualization of worldwide names and MAC addresses. He's trying to do that, and he finds out that in order to do that, he has to start the configuration from scratch because he didn't really upgrade his firmware, and because the firmware hasn't been upgraded, virtualization of worldwide names and MAC addresses may not have worked. He's working with physical addresses, but he's missing half of the functionality of Virtual Connect. And I see that pretty often. And if you have to do it from scratch, you might have to, on the fiber channel side, redo zoning. You might have to do reboots, depending on which version of firmware update utilities you use. So the external fiber channel switches must be at these minimum levels. Okay? And this is just the minimum levels. Let's see if I can... No. All right. So this is just the minimum levels. These are not the recommended levels. Of course, latest levels of firmware are much more recent. And for Ethernet switches, all external firmware is compatible. You want to check firmware dependencies in HP SPOC. You go to this website address I give you, and you look for, there's a database utility there that you can plug in hardware and it will give you dependencies. But there's also some documents there, PDFs, for Virtual Connect, which when you open will show you all the dependencies. When you open these documents, you want to look for red sections. That's the newest and the latest updates in the documents. You also want to look at release notes, but if release notes conflict with HP SPOC, you should use HP SPOC because that's what HP engineers use to see the firmware dependencies and to update the firmware dependencies first. The order of upgrade is extremely important with Virtual Connect. I usually try to make sure the external switches are all upgraded. And then the onboard administrator, then the ILOs on blades, and maybe FiberCard and NIC in blades, and then finally the Virtual Connect modules. So how do you upgrade? You want to read this guide, HP Blade System Provided Firmware Management Best Practices Guide. But you know the basic idea, if you don't want to read the whole guide, is for blades, you want to use the firmware DVD. All tools are on one DVD. You could pop it in and upgrade the firmware on the blades. In my last session, I missed this one item in the slide, and I will go over this now. There is HP Smart Update Manager software, which if you use it, it will know about all the dependencies, and it will upgrade all of it in the right order. Okay. There is also Virtual Connect Support Utility, which is a CLI tool you see here at the bottom on left, and at the bottom right you see HP Smart Update Manager. So the Virtual Connect Support Utility is a CLI tool. It has more granular functionality to upgrade in the firmware for Virtual Connect. And it has some things that the Smart Update Manager doesn't have, like a health check to see what firmware goes where. Okay. The general and fiber channel design. The goal is to minimize management. I always try to make sure that it's easy for you to use, but at the same time, you want to make sure that you have the best high availability, redundancy, and load balancing. So, general design tips. If you have multiple enclosures, you want to make sure you build the first enclosure and then import the second and the third and the fourth into the first Virtual Connect domain. What I see happening sometimes is people don't do that. They make separate Virtual Connect domains for each enclosure, not knowing about this, and then they will have to start from scratch again later. You want to daisy chain your Virtual Connect Ethernet modules with CX4 or SFP Plus cables, depending on which module you have, so that they form this one big loop. However, it's not really a loop, a loop in the network sense. It is a physical loop, but there is no loop problems like you have in the network. Okay, you'll see that in a moment. You want to use HP defined ranges for MAC address, worldwide names, and serial numbers, and you want to make sure that these ranges are not the same on each enclosure. So for first enclosure, you do the first range. For second, you do the second range. And finally, you want to make sure you have a very good naming convention, because things can get very confusing in Virtual Connect world. Here I'm suggesting a place-based naming convention where you name it by bay and closure number. There is a different naming convention out there based on function. I used to use that too. However, I find that the place-based naming convention that you see here works a little better, because if a blade fails and you move that profile over to a different blade, you'll know it's a temporary situation because it's not quite named correctly until you. So it's easier for you to notice that, and then when you replace your blade, everything will be back to where it was. So I find the place-based convention works better. Here's how you do enclosure stacking with Virtual Connect Ethernet or FlexFabric modules. The idea here, and unfortunately my laser pointer doesn't seem to work here, but the idea is, you see here in the first second from the top, you see four Virtual Connect modules. Let's say you put four. Well, horizontally, there is a connection between them on the backplane. You don't see it, but it's there. And vertically, you actually put a cable and connect these modules together. So you see from the second picture from the top, it's actually a circle, a loop. Okay. Now, the bottom picture, the most bottom picture, shows you eight modules, and let's say that the first four modules on the top are one enclosure, and the second four modules on the bottom are the second enclosure. So they don't have to be all eight modules in one enclosure. This can be two enclosures or four enclosures. The idea is that you treat it as one big circle, And that's how you connect your cables. Fiber channel design. You want to have one virtual connect fabric per fiber channel module with four external connections grouped, or if you have the 8 gigabit 24 port module, you can group all 8 connections into one pipe. Okay? It becomes much easier to deal with. And you want to make sure, of course, you have separate SAN switches, separate SAN fabrics. And then when you plug everything in, you use something called dynamic login distribution, where when you press the button, the traffic is distributed across all four modules. It doesn't do it automatically. You have to press the button. So let's say you group all the external connections into one fabric, and let's say you only have one physical external cable. You still group it into four, into one entity. Because what happens is, later, if you want to end more bandwidth, you could just take another cable, plug it in, hit the redistribute logins, and it just works. You don't have to redo any configuration. So it's very easy to add bandwidth. For fiber channel over Ethernet, FCOE, you can do up to 6 flex NICs and 2 flex HBAs on your blade, and more if you add more mezzanine cards. So here's the basic fiber channel design. Okay, let's start from the left here, from the blade on the left. You see here the blade has two HBA ports. So let's take the first one, HBA port 2, virtual worldwide name. And the signal goes to the top blue entity. And that blue entity is the virtual connect fabric. Okay, it's a logical entity existing inside the virtual connect module. And then that entity groups the four external ports of this physical module, which you see on the right, into itself. And then if you see the right physical module, from there there's only one physical connection going over to the external SAN switch. However, because you group them all in the same entity, the blue entity, you can now add more external connections later if you want. Okay, more than one that you see here. And then again, you see that one connection going to the switch on the bottom right switch. That is a Cisco, say, MDS9124 switch. And in that switch, you have a vSAN going. And in the vSAN, that's where your HBA port 2 worldwide name shows up. So the signal goes from the blade over to the blue entity, to the right module, and over to the Cisco MDS switch. Okay. And that's the signal on the right. Then you also have a redundant fabric on the left that does the same thing. And in the blade, you see that between the two ports, and the blade on the left, between the two green things on the left, you see that there's ESX multipathing. So if one path fails, the other one will automatically take over. So that's the basic fiber channel design. For FlexFabric, it's important to remember that you want to create the SAN fabric first. And then you assign the uplink ports to it. And then in the settings for the actual profile for the blade, you choose either fiber channel over Ethernet or iSCSI. You can't do both. Okay, that's only in the configuration of the actual service profile for the blade. That doesn't mean that you can't do both iSCSI and FCOE out of the module. You can do that. It's just in the blade, you can only do fiber channel over Ethernet or iSCSI. So mapped and tunneled modes. The goal is to get the most flexibility. So finally, and I'll talk about it in a moment, we now have these two separate modes that Virtual Connect used to have. Now you can do them both in the same Virtual Connect domain, without doing the configuration from scratch. And I'll talk about it in a second. So let's talk about map VLAN tags first. Okay? You want to have one Virtual Connect shared uplink set for all external ports per module, similar to what I described on the fiber channel side. When you group them together, and then you group them per module, and then you group the other module together. Okay? Some people say, well, why not go across modules? Have one shared uplink set that includes all ports from all modules, both left and right modules. Well, that's because the way a virtual network works is if you group them all in one entity, half the ports will be in standby and half will be active. Because you don't want to do that, you want to group them per module so that both sides are active. And then in your blade, you use teaming or, you know, load balancing with ESX to distribute traffic across those two paths. Also, you want to enable smart link on each VCNet. So what's smart link? Normally, let's say you don't enable smart link. If a path upstream dies, the blade will not detect it because the blade thinks it's connected to virtual connect. So it will not know that the path upstream network path died. So the port on the blade will think, oh, I'm connected. Well, it's going to send signal out, but it's going to go to nowhere. Okay. Why is that a problem? Well, if you enable teaming like I'm advising you, teaming relies on the fact that the network connection is dead. So if you have an upstream connection that's dead, but the blade doesn't know about it, teaming is not going to fail over your traffic from one side to the other side. Okay? So when you enable smart link, virtual connect, if it sees that the traffic is down on one side externally, it's going to notify the blade chip saying that, look, traffic on this side is dead. So kill your port. And the blade will kill the port. And now teaming will say, oh, the port is dead. I got to switch traffic. And it will switch traffic over. Okay. An interesting story I had, I think last year or the year before, I was doing this session. And there was a gentleman in the audience. I think his name was Peter. And he was from Time Warner. And right after the session, he ran up to me and said, you just saved me like $100,000. And I was like, huh? He said, they have a number of blade enclosures in Chicago and somewhere in California. And as you know, I was doing the sessions, they were having some major issues. Okay, they were having network, network issues. However, whoever set up the enclosures for them did not enable a smart link. So the blade couldn't fail over the traffic, and therefore, you know, they had major outages, all kinds of problems. So when he saw my session, he saw SmartLink, he ran back, he called his guys and said, enable SmartLink. And when he enabled it, everything was fixed. So that was a nice story that I've, you know, never had that before. But it's very important. SmartLink is very important. Also, you want to alternate between shared uplink sets for each port in the profile. You want to enable LACP port channels on Virtual Connect. Whatever the upstream switch is, you group the physical connections together into one big pipe using LACP, okay? And you also, on ESX, you use the virtual port ID teaming TLB load balancing. If you have limitations with the numbers of VLANs, although you'll see in a moment with the expanded VLAN capacity mode, that's becoming a thing of the past, you can use tunnel mode, and now you can use both tunnel mode and map VLAN tags mode together, okay? So here's a picture. Here's a picture of mapped VLAN tag mode, okay? So it's a little hard to explain without the pointer, but let's see. So here, all the way on the left, we have VMware ESX. Okay, and the picture there is kind of hard to see, but the picture there is VMware ESX virtual switch, distributed virtual switch, let's say, and some port groups there. Okay, so let's say we take the red one, the red port group, which is VLAN 20. Okay, so and we have a VM in that VLAN, so that VM stays in that port group. And then if it sends signal, the signal goes out through the virtual switch to the two VM NICs, which are actual physical NICs as far as ESX thinks. But in reality, they're just pieces of the chip that's inside the blade, okay, which you designate using Virtual Connect as, you know, this particular adapter has that much bandwidth. And when you do that, the adapter shows up as a physical adapter inside ESX. So the signal goes from that VM NIC over to the blade chip. Let's take the top one. It's a LAN on motherboard, LOM. And then the signal goes out to the top blue entity, okay? And you see that the actual line has mixed colors because over that line we have VLAN 20 going, but we also have other VLANs going, okay? So that goes to that blue entity. And the blue entity is a shared uplink set which groups all external ports in the module into one entity. And inside that entity, you see that you have a red item. That's our VLAN 20 VC network. So Virtual Connect understands that there's VLAN 20 in that entity. And then the signal will go out of the right Virtual Connect module. You'll see that there's only two connections. These are physical connections, only two physical connections. Even though I'm grouping all the ports in the module, there's only two physical connections here. Same thing as on the fiber channel side. I can add more physical connections if I want to. Okay? So, and then these physical connections, you see the little circle there, they're grouped together in the port channel, LACP port channel, going over to your switch, upstream switch, okay, on the bottom right. And then the upstream switch, network switch, has VLANs assigned, and you can see that there's a VLAN 20, and it's named development. And so that's how the signal goes. It goes, if you look all the way from the left, the red goes through from the port group over to the VMware virtual switch, over to the VM NIC, over to the blade chip, okay, over to the shared uplink set on top, and then to the right physical Virtual Connect module, over through the cable and down below to the network switch on the bottom right, that VLAN 20. However, over the same connection, all the other VLANs, if you look on the, all the way on the left, you see yellow and then there's a purple VLAN. All those VLANs also go over the same links, okay? And that's what map VLAN mode is that Virtual Connect presents multiple VLANs over to the actual ESX host. And ESX host understands that, oh, this VLAN 20, I have a little tag attached with number 20. I understand that. So I'm going to send the packet over on its way. That's if the OS understands VLAN tags, you use mapped VLAN mode. However, if the OS, let's say, does not understand what VLANs are, you just want a connection. Just plug it in, and there's network access. Okay. So in this case, on the bottom, you see a Windows machine, one blade, that does not have HP teaming driver, and it only understands a network connection, doesn't understand any VLANs. In this case, you can still assign a specific VLAN. So if you look in the Windows side box on the left where it says go, right, and you see the blade, and you see there's only one NIC there, and that NIC only understands a network connection, which is red. And that goes to that shared uplink set, which is red. And then it goes through the Virtual Connect module, through the external two connections, and out to the switch, and still reaches the red VLAN 20. However, you're assigning a specific VLAN, and you're stripping off the VLAN tag, so the OS only knows that it has a connection. So this is a way to have operating systems which don't understand VLAN tags still be inside your blade enclosure. So using map VLAN tags, you can do both ways, okay? And of course, here's another picture there with Flex 10. This is out of one of the HP cookbooks, which if you go look for Virtual Connect documentation, there's a number of cookbooks there which you should use. They give you all these pictures. They may be kind of complex, but you should definitely read some of them. So here's another picture here that HP made. It looks a little different, but the idea is the same, okay? You see here, let's say take the left side, okay? From the top, you have a blade with a profile on it, and you divide up the chip into it, in the blade, into four pieces, okay? You have the orange, the green, the blue, and the kind of light blue, okay? And then you see that the connections from there go to the Virtual Connect module, which is a gray entity in the middle. And on the left cloud, you see a whole bunch of little clouds. Okay, each of those clouds correspond to a specific VLAN. So let's take the orange one. The orange one exists, you know, on the chip, so the OS sees it. And then also Virtual Connect knows about it. The orange is in the cloud on the left. Okay, and then that same VLAN goes out to the switch on the bottom, the ProCurve 2900, and the ProCurve understands that VLAN also. Okay, so you see on the top, in the Virtual Connect profile, on the top left, you see that each FlexNIC is assigned one VLAN. The orange is orange, the green is green, the blue is blue. However, the light blue, it's not really light blue. It's actually a combination of light blue and gray. Why is that? Because to that particular FlexNIC, we're sending two VLANs. We're sending two VLANs, the light blue and the gray, what you see in the cloud below. So what you can see with FlexNICs, you can send either one VLAN to specific FlexNIC, or you can send multiple VLANs to specific FlexNIC. And that's the beauty of Virtual Connect. Here's another picture here. This is with the FlexFabric modules. So the idea is very similar to what we had before, okay? However, the FlexFabric ports can be configured to be either fiber channel or Ethernet, all right? So here, if you take the left module from the top, okay, you'll see this is the Virtual Connect module, and there is a two ports, the two leftmost ports that go to the orange SAN. Those two ports are grouped together in the SAN fabric, and there are your fiber channel ports. And then down below, these ports go to the chip, where there is a flex HBA. You divide the chip up into pieces, and you take one piece and you say, that's going to be my fiber channel HBA. So that orange goes to that fiber channel HBA, goes to the blade, and then all the way on the bottom of the blade on the left, there's two virtual HBAs. Okay? And that's where the signal goes. The orange goes there. So that's the fiber channel configuration. And then if you look on the leftmost module, Virtual Connect FlexFabric module, you'll see that there's a cloud, a sort of like light blue cloud in the bottom, okay? That's a shared uplink set that combines two ports on Virtual Connect module, and then inside it has all these VLANs or VC networks, same thing, and all of them go to the chip in the blade on the left, okay? And then the blade passes them over to ESX, where all these VLANs are now being understood by ESX, and they all divide up into separate port groups. There's a console management port group, there's a vMotion, VMware production port group, and so on. So with one FlexFabric module, with this design, you can divide up the module into fiber channel and Ethernet. And it's much more convenient. I know this module may be more expensive than a regular module, but this is the future. You should go with this module, okay? This is the module you should go with, all right? And of course, in the middle between the two modules, we have an actual cable for stacking configuration, okay? And here's just a picture that when you have multi-enclosure design in your ESX servers, let's say there's a enclosure on the top and an enclosure on the bottom. However, when you make your ESX clusters, you want to stack these enclosures together, and then you want to have blades in the cluster spread across two enclosures, okay, for redundancy purposes. In case one enclosure fails, the other enclosure will automatically take over. So don't have a cluster enclosure. Have a cluster distributed across two enclosures. So finally, what's new? Firmware 3.6 just got released. Okay, it was with 3.51 just recently. But in general, what is new? From last year, I was here and talking about this, you know, about this stuff in this session. That is significant. Well, there is this thing called network access groups. So what is it? Well, before you could say, all right, this server wants these particular VLANs, and you send these VLANs over to the server. Okay. Well, what if you have a cluster that hosts multiple servers? You know, there's a web server, there's application server, there's a database server, and you want a specific port on the blade to only access these specific VLANs and not other VLANs, okay? So what you do is you group these VLANs or these VC networks into a network access group, and you say, you know what, my database server is allowed to see VLAN 20 and VLAN 30. I'm going to put it in a network access group, assign it to this particular port, and that's what this port is going to see. Okay. However, my web server can see, you know, more VLANs, so I'm gonna put them into a network access group and assign them to my web server. Okay. Normally, this configuration is useful in large environments. I have not had a chance to see this in actual action yet because it's new and it's still, you know, it's limited to large, real large environments where you really want to have more security. It's more of a security conscious configuration, okay? More so than any performance or anything like that. It's for separation of specific VLANs, all right, and groups of VLANs. So that's network access groups. With our expanded VLAN capacity, and you see a picture here on the right, there is a there's a radio button there. It's hard to see, but you can do up to 1,000 VLANs per domain and 162 per physical module. That's if you have the latest Virtual Connect modules. If you have the 1 gigabit module, you can't do that. But in general, if you buy new modules, you can do that, and it's great. Some people before were limited by the amount of VLANs. They had a lot of VLANs. And as a result, they were forced to use tunneled mode. So I didn't really talk about tunneled mode because it wasn't the MEP VLAN mode is the default mode that everybody used to use. Well, now you can use both without doing the configuration from scratch. So let's say you do have that one server, okay, or a number of servers, and you're a really large environment, and you have more than 1,000 VLANs or something, okay? Then you can use tunneled mode. What that's going to do is, when you use tunneled mode, Virtual Connect will not understand VLANs. It'll just pass everything through it, okay? What will understand VLANs is your operating system, like ESX, and your upstream switch, network switch will understand VLANs, okay? However, when they pass through Virtual Connect, they'll just be passed as is. So the advantage is you can have as many VLANs as you want. The disadvantage is you can't be that granular with Virtual Connect network adapters and things like that. So MEP VLAN mode is the best. Use that. Only use tunneled in cases of really, really, really large numbers of VLANs. Okay. And now with the expanded VLAN capacity, some of that has been alleviated because they've added more VLANs. You could use more VLANs with a regular MEP VLAN mode. So port channels and VLANs. The idea is you want to consolidate the physicals, but separate the logicals. That's the trend in the industry. Consolidate all the physical stuff, like, you know, the blade enclosure, that's what it's for. But then you separate it into logical entities because it's much easier to deal with logical software-based entities. You know, you could just go click, 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 click. You don't have to connect anything. In the server profile, you want to alternate shared uplink sets for each NIC port. And there's this one limitation that I talk about is that you can't send the same VLAN to in two different places to the same chip. That's a limitation of Virtual Connect. So here, for example, we see that in the port 1 and 2, it's VLAN 10. Okay. However, in port 5 and 6, I'm also specifying VLAN 10. And you can't do that. Virtual Connect will complain and pop you a red error. How do you go about fixing that? Well, you just use, bless you, you just use a different VLAN number. So now here, on the top port, two ports, I used VLAN 13. And in 5 and 6, I used VLAN 10. And you won't have that problem. Okay. General VMware tips. In VMware 5, you have something called ESX host cache, okay? What is it? Well, I don't know if anyone used Windows and ReadyBoost, where you can take a flash USB drive, pop it in, and Windows will use it to offload its memory. So when it needs to write to disk, it'll write to that flash first, which is faster rather than writing to disk. Well, host cache on ESX is the same thing. If you have two internal SSD drives, you can designate them as your host cache. And if ESX servers run out of memory and is going to try to page to disk, it's not going to page to regular disk. It's going to page to these SSD drives first, and then it's going to page to disk. Okay? It's a very interesting functionality. It hasn't really been tested fully yet. There's not much documentation available on it yet on the exact details of it. However, I have enabled it. I have used it. And this is one reason why you might want to have local drives in your blades, Okay, I still recommend local drives, not boot from SAN, due to complexity of boot from SAN. However, this is one reason to actually have it for performance reasons, to have two local SSD drives for your ASX host cache. One thing you should be aware of is sometimes the local SSD drives are not recognized as SSD by ESX. All right, and I forgot to put the link in here, but there is a way to tweak ESX so it recognizes these internal drives as SSD. Okay. Just Google for the SSD host cache problem, and you'll see that there's a way to do that. You can increase the vMotion migration timeout to 35 for each of the ESX hosts, so that if you have any vMotions, there's no possible timeouts. This nowadays actually rarely happens. If you enable this tip, nothing will happen. Everything will be still feel fine. So if you don't enable it, you're probably going to be fine too. Okay. You also want to enable jumbo frames, especially if you're doing like iSCSI or something. And if you do that, you have to enable them everywhere in the path. You have to enable them in Virtual Connect, in your ESX, in your switches. Unless you enable them everywhere in the path, the functionality of jumbo frames will not work. Okay. Finally, for fault tolerance, if you're using that, you want to have at least 1 gigabit. Especially if you share with internal vMotion networks. So in your Virtual Connect, give it at least a gigabit adapter. Okay. There's something called Net IOC in VMware. Okay. If any of you are familiar with quality of service on the network side, this is it for VMware. So what is it? Well, if there's network contention, if there's too many things network-wise going on inside ESX, you can say, you know what? This traffic, which is my financial system traffic, is more important. And this other traffic, which is my regular home user folder traffic, is not that important. And you say, the traffic that's more important, I'm going to give it a larger share of bandwidth. And this only kicks in if there's contention. If there's no contention, nothing kicks in. However, if there's contention between the traffic that you gave a priority will win. Okay. And this is what Net IOC is in VMware. You want to use shared instead of limits. You'll see that when you're configuring it. You want to separate the fiber channel traffic onto separate 4 gigabit FlexNIC and all the other traffic onto 6 gigabit inside Virtual Connect. For iSCSI, you just want to use 10 gigabit for everything. You can only do Net IOC if you have distributed virtual switches. And you want to use this route based on physical NIC load policy. When the traffic does get to Virtual Connect, the QoS is not honored now. But so that the policy that you establish in VMware, it's not going to really translate to Virtual Connect. But you can still use Net IOC. You will still have some separation traffic on the ESX side, which is good. And if you have specific needs, where you want one specific lane of traffic dedicated in hardware just for a specific purpose, then don't use Net IOC. Finally, Cisco Nexus 1000V. So this is a Cisco distributed virtual switch, which actually replaces the VMware distributed virtual switch. It's inside VMware ESX. It's a software-based switch. Recommendation is you only want to use it if you have a large Cisco environment and your Cisco admins are demanding that they have access to the virtual switches. Then you would get the Nexus 1000V. There's a couple of other advantages that with Nexus 1000V, it has like better QoS policies, better monitoring, and so on. But in general, what I see so far is people only install it if they have a Cisco requirement. Otherwise, you want to use the VMware's distributed virtual switch, which is much simpler, doesn't have as many bells and whistles, but much simpler and much more stable. Okay. So here's the configuration with Cisco distributed virtual switch, 1000V. You see a switch on the right. Let's start from the right. This is a hardware switch on the right, upstream switch. And then it plugs into the two Virtual Connect modules on the left. And then inside, you see inside on the left with all the blue things, that are ESX hosts. And they have these pieces of software these gray boxes on top of them, these are pieces of software that installed on each ESX host. These pieces of software are called virtual Ethernet modules. And they're treated like line cards in a, let's say, a hardware switch. So the switch is distributed across all the physical hosts. It looks like one entity logically, but it really runs on all of these physical ESX hosts. Okay? And inside the switch, on the bottom left, you have some VMs. Okay? And they run on top. So here's some tips with it. Is that if you use the 1000V, use it for your general virtual machine traffic. Still though, create a regular VMware distributed virtual switch and use that for your console management and vMotion traffic. Why? Because if something breaks, it's much easier to fix the VMware virtual switch, distributed virtual switch, than Cisco's. Okay? You want to use a virtual appliance for it. While you want to think of these pieces of software on each ESX host as line card like. However, when you do port channels, in normal switch, you can do port channel across line cards. Here, you cannot do a port channel across two ESX hosts. You can only do a port channel per ESX host. And finally, let's see. Let's go to the next slide. You want to use the shmod command to detect failures with the virtual Ethernet modules. And you want to use these other commands, some very common useful commands, show interface brief and so on, show port channel summary for other purposes. Finally, you want to use one system uplink profile for all Nexus management traffic. Some documentation recommends two, but if you do one, it makes things much easier. Here's the configuration that you would use with Virtual Connect and 1000V. The important thing to remember in here is use something called MAC pinning. There's like three ways you can do the configuration, but you want to use the MAC pinning configuration, which actually pins the paths through Virtual Connect directly and into Nexus 1000V. And it's much easier, and that is a supported configuration. Finally, make sure you spend time on design before you build a solution, because with C-Class Blades, Virtual Connect, and VMware vSphere, if you don't plan ahead of time, you may have problems down the line. So always do design and planning ahead of time. And please fill out the survey. I would like to thank these people here in Ericsson, Chris Lynch, Greg Fields, and HP in general for cookbooks and images that I use in this presentation. I'll try to give you the file after this. Just catch me after these questions. But email me for questions or give me your business card. I'll email you the slides also or email me any questions. Thank you and open for questions, please. Questions? No questions. Let's see, go in once. Let's see, where's Brian Rice here? Oh, yes, question.
When is 5-channel over Ethernet going to be supported?
So you mean upstream? Okay. Well, the question was, when is fiber channel over Ethernet going to be supported upstream? Since I'm not an HP guy, you may want to go into the CDA session, the non-disclosure session, or the area there, and ask them, because I'm a reseller doing this on a regular basis, so I don't know. Okay, any questions? Yes. So the question was, you're familiar with, and thank you for coming to my sessions. You've been coming every year, and I actually went to your class too, so thank you. The setting used to be there was a global change for tunneled versus mixed mode. So what happened was, if you put it to tunneled and you just go with tunneled mode, if you want to switch later, you have to switch. You have to erase everything, switch the setting, and start the configuration from scratch. Okay. Now you're allowed to switch. It's no longer global. Okay. So yes, it's a welcome change, and that you can mix both tunnel and map configurations in the same configuration. Although I would say that map mode is much better still. Uh, the question was, what is the mapped versus tunneled mode attached to? And you know what? I forgot the exact point where it's at, so I will give it to you afterwards. Okay, thank you. Questions? Any more questions? See, Brian Rice, where are you? Brian? No? Thank you. Appreciate it. All right. Any other questions, please get me, and I will get you the presentation on stick.